my turn, I've been told, so I better get going here. Thanks, Harry, for doing that, and obviously, Janka, for leading the discussions and for the great introduction as well. And thanks for being here on a Friday morning. Indeed, when I studied, the weekend started on Thursday night, and probably the week started on Tuesday. But anyway, what I wanted to talk about was very quickly a little bit what is happening in society and what should affect us all, including the university, and then what type of leadership is needed to function in this world that we are creating for ourselves, or perhaps the world we should create. So I'll do that for about half an hour, and then it might be good to just get into a much more interesting exchange of thoughts or ideas. The, my wife and I were coming here yesterday from flying in from the UK, and we were both waiting at City Airport. And I don't know if you've ever been to City Airport, but they're very small, cozy rooms before you catch this little plane that is basically a 40-minute flight between London City and Rotterdam. And we heard three people talking. And it was very clear to me very quickly. And normally, my wife always tells me, don't listen in, that's unpolite. But I know everybody does, so why should I do it? And I quickly figured out that one was a doctor, one was an engineer, and one was an economist. And the doctor said, we have the oldest profession. You go back to the book of Genesis, and you see that Eve came out of the rib of Adam. Both survived. So, successful operation. Doctors, oldest profession. So the engineer said, I don't think so. When the universe was created, it was created out of chaos. And anybody who can create order out of chaos must be an engineer. Engineer, oldest profession. The economist said, absolutely not. Economist is the oldest profession, because who created chaos in the first place? And I think we're talking about that. We're living in a world that I often have described the world as a VUCA world, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. Never ever has change been so slow as it is today. And that's because, obviously, for a lot of reasons. The world is becoming increasingly interdependent, the financial world, technology driving that, borders are coming down rapidly. It sometimes doesn't look like that if you see CNN or some of the things going on, but we're living in an incredibly globally interdependent world. Take a state of California, 20% of the CO2 effects that you have in California are actually coming from China. So what happens in one place affects another place at an increasing speed. And we struggle with that very clearly. Never ever has change been so slow as it is today. In fact, what happens in this decade, if you want to, in the 10 years that we're talking about, the 10 years that you're studying here, the 10 years perhaps that you're going to join the workforce, is that a few megatrends are coming together that the world has never seen before. And therefore, the issues that now need to be addressed were not addressed before, because they simply weren't burning platforms. And I'll talk about that very quickly, what these trends are. And I like to limit it on, perhaps limit it to two or three trends that affect us all. There are obviously many trends that we can talk about, like an aging population or a more global society or any of the other trends. But the three trends that affect us all is, the first one is this rapid change that you see in the world moving again to the east and the south. If you now take 68% of the world population lives in Asia, currently it's about 28% of the global GDP. In 15 years' time, that will be 60% of the global GDP. So, in fact, we're going back to before the Industrial Revolution, where the center of the Earth was obviously a function a little bit of the population. China closed itself off, Industrial Revolution came, the UK and the US obviously did extremely well. One shrank, the other expanded, and it created that difference in power fields. Now it's rapidly coming back, and the world struggles with that. The world struggles with that. Another example would be China. You take China, for example. There are now 235 cities in China, over 1 million people, inhabitants, and by the end of this decade, Europe itself has 35 cities. So you see the enormous differences that are going to happen. The result of that a little bit is a vacuum in global governance. I think that is the biggest thing that you have to take out of this. The US clearly shrinking back to its own territory, if they like that or not. India, China not really able or willing to take the global stage yet and match the size of their countries with the responsibility that comes with it. They still claim far too often developing world status. And as a result, we see a vacuum. And how does that vacuum play out? That vacuum plays out by not concluding Doha rounds or climate change agreements or entering in the lowest common denominator in the Rio plus 20 declaration, which was an incredibly missed opportunity. It plays out by watching television every night and looking at Syria now like a soap opera, a daily spectacle that nobody does anything. It plays out by having a European crisis, which frankly hasn't been addressed at all, but nobody does anything because it's kind of quiet right now. It plays out really by a lack of global governance at a time that the world needs it most. Trend number one. Trend number two is what I would call, the first trend I would call the new Asian hemisphere. It's in fact the title of a book from Kishore Mububani, who teaches at the Lee Kuan Yew School of Management in Singapore. The second trend, I would call it the consumer in charge. The consumer in charge is the trend that you understand better than anybody else, which is the digitization of society. And we now have about 2.3 billion people connected on the internet already. In 10 years' time, about half of the world will be connected on the internet. Facebook, with 1.2 billion users, is the third biggest country after China and India. And increasingly, these people, the people of this world, especially the young people, understand that they are connected. And it results again in interesting things. It gives, whilst you might have read in the papers that the wealth that is being accumulated in this world is increasingly concentrated. It's not a good thing. But the wealth is created, we were just talking that, in the capital markets. Oxfam issued a study not long ago that said that the 85 richest people in the world, 85 richest people in the world, are less than there are here. They could be in a double-decker bus in the UK. 85 of the richest people have the same wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people. Wealth is increasingly concentrated, but the power, in fact, is increasingly dispersed amongst all of us. And we are increasingly aware of that. I remember an image in China when I was watching one of the things on television where this Chinese village was fed up with the corruption that was happening around land parceling out, where these farmers were being forced to give up their land at very cheap prices and others would sell it through for construction at very inflated prices. A form of corruption, you might call it, but the farmers finally caught on and they were protesting. It was a very small village. Police encircled the village, police had all the weapons, and a journalist was there from one of the television stations, talked to a lady, she looked in her 60s, and they said to the lady, aren't you afraid, with all these guns pointing at you, that you know what you're doing doesn't lead to a positive end? And she said, no, we're not. She said, we might not have weapons, but we have this. And she took her iPhone out, and she says, we have the world just to watch what is happening. And that's exactly what is happening right now. The consumers understand that. You get the Arab Spring. It's a good example of that. The Arab Spring was a regime of Mubarak that had been in office for more than 40 years. Very ingrained regime. There always was corruption. There always was rising and fluctuating food prices. There always was high level of unemployment. So why now? Why now? And if you trace that back, it's very simple. We organize on Facebook. We communicate with each other on Twitter. We show the world what we do on YouTube. It's actually the first revolution, if you want to, aided by the internet. And you saw the same on the square in Turkey. It wasn't really about cutting down trees. It was really about, do we want a secular state or not? 1 million people come on the streets in 2 minutes. You saw it on the streets of Brazil. It wasn't about rising bus fares. It was about, we want a government that is not corrupt, that invests in us and infrastructure and all the other things. You see it in the streets of Ukraine. You saw it when the Indian girl tragically was raped and killed on the bus in India. That was normal there, nobody did anything. It was when the young and the mothers went onto the streets. Again, by the hundreds of thousands, by the millions, that justice was done in a relatively short period of time. The power of consumers now is incredible. Politicians struggle with that. It makes the first trend actually even more difficult to deal with. Instant feedback, instant action, instant demands, polarizing opinions, very difficult for politicians to deal with that. Not equipped themselves to internalize to their own constituents some of these global challenges I'm talking about. The third trend, I would call it the end of the era of abundance. It's a very easy trend to see. We obviously have had an enormous wealth accumulation in especially Europe and the US. But we've done that by using quite a lot of resources. You take the top 1 billion people in this world uses 75% of the world's resources. The bottom 1 billion people in this world, what you might call the poorest people, only use about 1% of the world's resources. But yet they all aspire to live like the top. It just doesn't add up. WWF did a study, it's now 2 years old already, that said already today we are using 1.5 times the Earth's resources. 1.5 times. Now I'm less smart than you are, the students today are far smarter than when we were studying, but I do know we have only one Earth. It doesn't add up. In fact, if we would all live like Americans, we would need 3 Mother Earths, and we don't have that. John Rockstrom, who lives works in the Stockholm, and he works for the Resilience Institute in Stockholm, has created 9 biomarkers, which he calls the health of the planet. And of these 9 biomarkers, biodiversity, climate change, nitrogen levels, are already beyond what anybody would reasonably accept as minimal acceptable standards. So there's a tremendous challenge. 100 billion tons in the next 10 years, just 100 billion tons of minerals will be dug out of the earth to give us packaging and all that stuff, of which less than 10% is going to be recycled. I was in Russia on Thursday and Friday, 1% recycling rate. I was in Turkey 2 days before, 1% recycling rate. How long can we go on digging holes? And this is before 2 billion plus more people come into this wealth. And this is when many aspire still to increase their standards of living. It just doesn't add up. So I call that the end of the era of abundance. 3 major trends. Now, what do these trends mean for us? And obviously, the last trend of overuse of the resources really have to make you question how we make an economic model grow whilst putting less pressure on the earth. So you probably still remember Winston Churchill. Winston Churchill said, democracy is the worst form of governance, except for all the other ones that were invented. And he was right. I've gone to many countries in the world. I travel to about 50 a year, and I see many of them. And I still believe myself that democracy, well functioning, is the best form of governance to drive prosperity for all. The same can be said about capitalism. Capitalism is the worst economic system, except for all the other ones invented. I think the crisis of 2007-2008 taught us a great lesson. I've always said it's more a crisis of morality than it was breaking the law. It is true that some people are now getting certain amounts of fines, but in reality, very little was done in terms of breaking the law. Very few people went to jail. But the crisis of 2007-2008 made us realize, I think, more than ever, that our system of economic growth was really not sustainable. Although in the last 40 years, we had lifted 500 million people out of poverty. We had brought education to many people. We had brought healthcare. In fact, the Millennium Development Goals of halving the number of people living on poverty was actually achieved in the last 15 years. Some say mainly due to China, but it's always mainly due to this, mainly due to that, but it has been achieved. So globalization, capitalism, if you want to, democracy that was obviously underlying that in most parts of the world, has actually lifted more people out of poverty than at any time in history. But the crisis of 2008-2009 made us realize that it had come at an enormous price. That it had come at an enormous price of government debt or private debt, enormous price of over-consumerism in some parts of the world, and frankly, leaving too many people behind. Now, you know better than I do that any system that is not in equilibrium or where too many people feel that they are excluded or not fully participating will ultimately be rejected. It's like a cancer in your body. We have to be very respectful in the way we live. We live with our fellow citizens, and we live with Mother Earth. And any time if that balance is, or that equation is out of balance, you will get friction. You will get friction. And that is the tension you see happening in this world. No system long time will succeed if too many people feel that they are not participating. Too many people feel that they are excluded. Now, there are some, and unfortunately too many universities still as well, who just teach very single-mindedly the law of economics, the Milton Friedmans, the Adam Smiths, the invisible hand, and the discussion often goes for, well, if there are problems, perhaps then the price mechanism will adjust. If there's climate change, if there's a scarcity of energy, the price will go up so much that people will use it less, and we will have a little bit of technology, and we will solve it. So let the free market reign. There's still some politicians out there, not anymore the majority, fortunately, but there's still some politicians out there that believe that. Let the free market reign. Well, if the free market, let the free market reign, we now live in the year 2014. We've had a long time to let free markets reign. Why is it today, even today still, that nearly a billion people go to bed hungry, not knowing if they even wake up the next day? Why is it today still? And by the way, they're not your children that go to bed hungry. Why is it today that still 2.8 billion people don't have access to clean water or sanitation in this world? By the way, they're not your families. Why is it today that more than 4 billion people, mainly girls, don't have access even to the legal system in this world? They're not your daughters. Why is it today that 2 million children unnecessarily die under the age of 5 from infectious diseases that can be prevented with the simple act of hand washing? They're not your children either. They're all making it past the age of 5. At least I assume. So if this invisible hand is such a powerful thing, why are we dealing with these enormous challenges? Consumers becoming increasingly dissatisfied, pressures to solve many of these issues increasing, end of the era of abundance, and governments increasingly unable to deal with that because of the governance structures that we have created, which are basically local structures that don't function anymore in an interdependent world. Most of the institutions that we try to govern the world with today are institutions that are developed in Bretton Woods period that you're well familiar with. The World Bank, the IMF, the G8, that's now the G7, we're actually shrinking there, the G20. That's not anymore equipped with how the world functions. And many countries, especially the G77, which are the poorer countries, feel that they are grossly excluded from the global governance process at a time then that they are desperately wanting to be more included and deserve to be more included. So what do you do? What do you do if you run a company? What do you do if you run a company when you see that governance that normally has played that role is not playing the role that it should be playing, that the pressure points are all coming together in this and increasing? So the only thing you can do is take core responsibility. You can't run away from that. Companies need to start thinking about what they can do to make a positive contribution. Business has usually operated, and still unfortunately operates in most of the world and most of the businesses, by just saying, I need to stay on the right side of the law. Let the government set the law, let the government set the frameworks, and I'll try to stay on the right side of the law. In fact, if I make a little bit more money than I was thinking, I might do some philanthropical things. In fact, if I'm a little bit smarter about it, I might do some CSR by linking it to one of my products, helping some poor people in Africa so I can sell a little bit more. But that's basically where business is right now. But that's not enough anymore. I don't think that's anymore what consumers will understand and consumers will accept. In today's environment, you need to have a business model that actually makes a positive contribution to solving the issues that are there. The issues of poverty, the issues of food security, the issues of climate change, the issues of unemployment. If you don't make a positive contribution, you'll be rejected increasingly so. Less good, not enough anymore. Business cannot be a bystander in a system that gives them life in the first place. If society doesn't function, and you see many examples now on television, we're just starting another spectacle in Iraq. We have the Ukraine, we have Syria. It's nearly on a daily basis. And if it's not geopolitical tension, it is climate change tension. By the way, just on climate change alone, just to give you one fact, in the last 10 years alone, this world has incurred $3.7 trillion more in costs to cover natural disasters than in any normal pattern in its history. I was in the Philippines just a few weeks ago talking with President Benito Aquino about Hurricane Haiyan. That's an area the size of from London to Moscow. It's 10% of the total land surface, basically wiped out. And I don't know if you know that, but if climate change happens, it's the poor that suffer. It's not the rich that suffer. When Hurricane Sandy hit the United States, I have two sons living in New York. They had great anecdotes that they had to walk the stairs instead of using the elevator. So walking 50 stairs isn't that great to stay in shape. They had some cozy nights because they were candle nights and the girlfriends came over without any doubt. But the people in Haiti, the people in Haiti were put back at least another 2 years. They're still recuperating from it. They're still recuperating from it. So with that same force that citizens of this world can reject these governments now, these governments, by rallying together and coming into the streets and demanding change, they can do the same with companies and reject companies. I always say it, if it takes 17 days to topple a regime in Egypt, it can take nanoseconds to topple a company. There are 60,000 companies in this world quoted on the stock exchanges. It sounds a small number, but there's not more. The rest is private, some small SMEs. But the public companies in which we all invest in the stock market is 60,000. Now, Pareto's law applies here as well, that the top 1,000 companies of these 60,000 make up half the market cap. We're one of them, not surprisingly. And these companies have seen their market caps go up and down like a yo-yo now. Up and down like a yo-yo. Why? It's very simple. Because they were buying products from the Rana Plaza factory in Bangladesh because it was so cool to have a $1 t-shirt. Now, is it cool to force 1,050 women into a factory that they knew that was at the point of collapsing and they unnecessarily lost their life? Was it cool that they were paid 11 cents an hour to do this? About as close to modern-day slavery as it gets. In fact, the next lowest paid country in the world was Vietnam at 26 cents, more than 2.5 times as much as these women were paid. It's not cool anymore to sell horse meat and tell people it's beef. It's not cool anymore to manipulate LIBOR rates or foreign exchange rates or repackage mortgage rates and sell them to innocent citizens. It's not cool anymore to treat your people in the value chain with disrespect or try to gain your money at the expense of others. Fortunately, that transparency of the internet, that aggregation of voices, has made that possible to see it. I don't believe business, like governments, is worse now than they were before, nor do I believe they're better now than they were before. I just believe it's an age of much more transparency, where consumers can aggregate their voices and say, we have enough. And as a result, you see the market cap of these companies go back and forth. So we said very simply, Unilever has always been a very good company. That's why I joined them. I joined them about 6 years ago. And one of the things that has always been has always impressed me was the values of this company. But we have never really, we came through a period in the 90s, mid-2000s, where we were not able to put this all together in a successful business model. So the company was suffering. Sales were going down, more short-term. Investments were cut that really were needed for the long-term. And we said we really need to do something else. Obviously, we needed to create a growth model again for the company. But we also said we need to do that in a different way. We created what was called the Unilever Sustainable Living Plan, which basically said we're going to double our turnover. Remember, there's still 2.5 billion people coming to this world. Still many need to improve their qualities of life. No problem at all. We're going to double our turnover, but we're going to do this in a more sustainable and equitable way. In fact, we're going to double it by reducing our absolute footprint, total decoupling of growth and resource use, total decoupling. Total decoupling. Double the business, half the environmental footprint. At the same time, improve the overall social impact. Now, what is unique about that model is that no company of our size or scale has said that. It covers the total value chain. CSR usually stays into your own territory, your offices, your factories, perhaps your travel. If you're lucky, the plane of the CEO. But that's basically where CSR stops. We said that's not enough anymore. We have to take responsibility of the total value chain. From the farm, if you're in the food business, to the fork, where the product gets eaten. And you look at all the issues related to that. I give you an example why that is important. A company like Unilever, in our own shop, for example, our CO2 emission is about 4 million tons of CO2. That's our factories, travel, the things I talked about. In our total value chain is over 400 million tons of CO2, 100 times more. The pesticides or the fertilizers on the land, the transport of your products from the land to the home, the boiling of the water to cook your products, these are all CO2 impacts. the packaging that you need, or the forests that are being cut to produce the food that we all demand. So these are your total CO2 impacts in your value chain. Taking a responsibility of the total value chain, if you would cut it by 10% across this total value chain, is 40 million tons in our case. 40 million tons is 10 times more than if I would have zero CO2 in my own shop. So you have to move from your own shop to total value chain. It covers obviously all of our brands, all of our countries. It's our business model. And then it is also covering not only the economic part, but also the social and environmental. You know, capitalism is actually not a very bad thing, but capitalism is currently narrowly focused on optimizing the return on capital. It's a purely narrow definition of what return is. Unfortunately, still taught in too many, if not all, universities. But it wasn't meant to be. You should not only optimize your financial return on capital, you should also optimize your economic and social returns on capital. What we now conveniently call the environmental P&L and the social P&L. As long as we value a dead tree more than a tree alive, we will not make it, because we'll keep cutting. It still doesn't work. You have to include in your economic models the externalities. Someone is paying for that. We started to finally understand that with tobacco, that tobacco companies can earn a lot of money, but we are all paying for the cost of healthcare. That's an example of externalities. You need to make that part of the business model, otherwise you never optimize that. So our model is an integrated model where we try to optimize the economic, social, and environmental. It makes good sense. It makes good sense. It makes good sense from our business point of view. We cut costs. We've cut $400 or $500 million out of costs by looking at waste differently. It makes good sense from a risk point of view. For risks, we now look at what will happen with climate change, where should we develop new crops, how should we deal with smallholder farmers and other things. It makes good sense from an innovation point of view. I was in India a few weeks ago, I'm there again in 2 weeks' time, and the last time I was there, this lady says to me, Mr. Polman, today I have to decide if I cook, if I wash my hair or if I wash my clothes. I said, why do you have to decide if you wash your hair or wash your clothes? She said, I simply don't have enough water. So if you invent products that use less water, for example, a waterless shampoo, which is doing extremely well for us, or a fabric softener where you only need one rinse versus three rinses, you obviously create innovations that make more sense, that are more appealing to people that, especially in these emerging markets, live in resource-scarce areas. So it cuts costs, it takes risks away, it drives innovation. But what I'm most excited about is that it goes to your brands, it gives your brands an enormous opportunity to make a difference. We're a branded goods company, and our brands should be there to serve society. When I became CEO, I made it very clear that we were not there for the shareholders. We were there for the citizens of this world, and if we would serve them well, the shareholders would do well. But only if we would serve them well, if we would serve the citizens well, the shareholders would do well. Our focus is not the shareholders. But the shareholders' gain is a result of what we do. That should be the case for every company, to the service of society. So putting the brands to the service of society is enormously powerful. I talked about these big issues of food security, 1 billion people going to bed hungry, or the 2 million children dying every year of infectious diseases, or still the 2.5 billion people that don't have a toilet and do open defecation. These are also enormous opportunities for brands if you can respond to that. So what I'm most excited about is that we are creating increasingly the brands that make a positive contribution. Dove, one of our brands, stands for women's self-esteem. Lots of actions in school to give women self-confidence. Brand growing double digit. Our Knorr brand, or in the Netherlands, Unox, helps smallhold farmers or drives the market to sustainable farming. Brand is doing well, thank you very much. Our Domestos brand, which is one of our toilet cleaning brands, working to increase the access to toilets for another 400,000 or 500,000 people in the world. Brand was our fastest growing brand last year, with another brand called Lifebuoy. Lifebuoy was a brand that was invented by Lord Lever in the 18th century. Brand is 150 years old. 6 years ago, discussions were there if the brand should be stopped or not, because it's an old brand, nobody buying it anymore. We said, heck no. It's called Lifebuoy. Why did anybody call it Lifebuoy? They called it Lifebuoy because in Victorian Britain, when Lord Lever started his company, by the way, he didn't care about the shareholders, never heard of them. He didn't even create that for them. He created Lifebuoy because in Victorian Britain, one out of two babies would never make it past the age of five. That's why he created it. There was an enormous need for hygiene. Lifebuoy is now fully concentrating on helping a child reach the age of five. So if I now talk to the Lifebuoy people, they don't say, I'm selling soap. They say, I help a child reach the age of five. Now just look at this ad for 1 second, and I'll wrap up on some comments on leadership, if you can do that. Probably have to turn the lights down a little bit. We found it on YouTube, so I hope it works. He was telling me, you're not cool if you don't put a YouTube thing in your talk. So that's it.
बच्चा 5 साल का हो गया।
इतना सब 5 साल में कौन सी बड़ी बात है?
बड़ी बात है मैडम, ये गुंडापा का पहला बच्चा है जो 5 साल की उम्र तक पहुंचा है।
Great, not surprising. Lifebuoy is growing 14%, by the way, and hand washing is now, we've reached just in the last 5 years alone, 300 million people. 300 million people. In the previous 100 years, we had reached 50 million people. It creates a little bit more energy if you're helping a child reach the age of five. Sustainable farming, we were at 10%, and by the way, we were seen as one of the best companies, started a sustainable agriculture initiative. We were the founders of the round table of sustainable agriculture, our round table of palm or soy. We created the marine stewardship for sustainable fishery. Nothing to be ashamed of at all. But we were only actually 14% sustainably sourced. That's how difficult it is. In 2008, 2009, we're 48% sustainably sourced now. five times as much just in 5 years' time as the previous 100 years. We're running all of our factories now at zero waste. Green energy in Europe is the norm. There's absolutely no compromise on that. And the interesting thing is we're running it fairly efficiently. In fact, we're running it better now as a company than we were before. Our share price, by the way, is up 98% over the last 5 years. Nobody's complaining. So somehow, it also makes good business sense. I too often still get the question, why do you do all this? Why do you do all this? And how do you justify this? And my simple answer is always, why don't you ask all these other companies out there, why don't they do this? Isn't that the question we should be asking? Why do we continue to waste resources that we don't have? Why do we continue to put our own interest ahead of the interest of serving society? Why do we still accept people to operate under standards that show gross disrespect for others who've had less opportunities than we have? Those are the questions that should be asked. We are very fortunate to be in 190 countries. We have about 2 billion consumers using us every day. So we reach more people than governments. So we set these targets of reaching another billion people with health and well-being, converting markets to sustainable palm oil, getting out of deforestation. And we can use the size and scale of our company, sometimes industry associations, our total value chain to convert. And that's where I personally get most of my satisfaction. One example is deforestation. If you're in the food business, you have to be co-responsible for solving the issue of illegal deforestation. I don't know if you're interested or not, but as a small detail, illegal deforestation accounts for about 17% of global warming. So if you're not interested now, hopefully you're interested in a few years. But it's driven for half of that by the demand for food, so we have to be co-responsible for that. Created the Tropical Forest Alliance. We put industry associations together. We make commitments to go out of selling products that come from illegal deforestation. We work with governments, with world banks, and others, the smallhold farmers, the indigenous tribes, to move the world out of illegal palm oil. Governments have a hard time doing that by themselves in today's world. Citizens will increasingly demand that, and they will look for companies that take that positive business model to make a positive contribution to solve the things. The issues of food security. We've talked enough about the billion people that go to bed hungry every night. But yet, we're capable of wasting 30 to 40% of food in a total value chain. 1 billion people going to bed hungry, and on the other end, 1.2 billion people causing what is soon to be known as the biggest epidemic in this world, which is diabetes 2. People that are obese, eating more than 4,000 calories a day. How can we let these billion people go to bed hungry whilst we're wasting 30 to 40% of the food and have, on the other side, the obesity issues? Shouldn't we be part of the solution for that? And by the way, it only takes 1% more food, which is the amazing thing, to let these people not go to bed hungry. And yet we call ourselves the most intelligent species. Something to think about. And we have an incredibly hard time getting it on the agenda of any governments these days. That's the saddest part of it, not on the G8, not on the G20s, etc. So what leaders do we need? What business models do we need? Obviously, the business model needs to be longer term. You need leaders that really have four characteristics, as far as I'm concerned. You always, by the way, need the normal leadership skills that you find in a textbook, and I leave them up to you because you open every book and you'll have the 10 points of leadership or how to play piano in 5 minutes. I'll leave those things to you. But you need four things that are absolutely crucial. You need people that have a higher level of awareness of what is going on out there. You can't just live in your own cocoon. You need people that have a higher level of engagement, that are willing to connect and help provide solutions. You need people with a high level of humanity. And you need people with a high level of humility as you go about these tasks. If you have those four characteristics, that come a long way. You need people that can, the high level of awareness gets you to systemic thinking. Again, something that is rarely taught at universities, where many of the studies are done in silos. The complexities of today's issues are very difficult to grasp. A food issue quickly leads you to a water issue, and a water issue quickly leads you to an energy issue. And how do you solve that? It's like a balloon sometimes. You squeeze it on one side, it pops up on another side. You need people that can understand these complexities and boil them down in simplicities and then drive them to concrete action, systemic thinking. You need people that can work with a higher level of purpose, again, grossly lacking in many of our educational institutions. People that understand that the interest of the common good has to be put ahead of their own interest. People that understand that they're very fortunate to belong to the 1 or 2% that can go to school or make an academic career that can do what they want, but that should be put at the service of the other 98% who can't fight for themselves. So you need people that do systemic thinking, you need people with a higher level of purpose, and you certainly need people that can work together in partnership. It was Einstein who said the definition of insanity is to do the same thing over and over again and expect different results. If we want to solve these major problems of food security, of climate change, of social exclusion and poverty, we need to work at a different level than we've created these problems. It requires an enormous level of partnership based on mutual trust, understanding, transparency. Lots of people have difficulties with that. But if you don't have that trust, and if they don't have that transparency, you don't get trust. If you don't have trust, you don't get prosperity. So these are the skills of future leaders. Systemic thinking, deeper sense of purpose, a higher sense of partnership, and doing things for the long term. Now, for the women in the audience, I'd just like to end by just saying that many of the academics will agree with me, and Peter Sinch of MIT has written many books about it, that these skills that I just talked about actually are more suitable or come more naturally to the female race than the male race. The maternal instinct, the longer term thinking, the partnerships. So if any woman is worried about their role in future society because we've grossly short-circuited you, I am not at all. In fact, there's just a book that came out in the US that is called The End of the Era of Man. Now, I don't subscribe to that either, but I certainly think it is the era of women. Thank you very much.